Welcome to Transforming Times in Christ. My name is Anthony Cunningham, and I'm happy to be spending this time with you today, just dwelling in God's plan and in His Word. You know, this show is Transforming Times in Christ, because that's what the Lord wants to do in our life. It's awesome how He accepts us and receives us right where we're at, and wants to come in and do such a major change in our personal lives. Through relationship with Him and through the way, we think. I remember hearing a preacher say, you know, we've all been homeschooled in the wrong school. You know, and it's just another way of saying, you know, there's a way that seems right to us, the way we were raised and the way that we automatically think according to our flesh. And God wants to come in and retrain us. The scripture says that we are transformed by the renewing of our mind. And we're transformed, you know, by the Word of God and coming to know Him. You know, what's so amazing is that you can know God just like you know another person. You spend the quality time with Him in prayer and listening to His Holy Spirit and spending time reading in His Word and believing it. You can come to know God and who He created you to be. And it's a transforming thing when you come to know Him. If you spend time with the Lord, spend time in the Word, you know, it would be really hard to remain the same when you put your faith in these things. So that's what He wants to do. And I know that, you know, we are saved, the scripture says, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And I just wanted to, you know, take some opportunity and just share some testimonies on what God's been doing, you know, just out here on the streets in Quincy. And you know, I have a business where I have to haul a lot of brush, and we've been cleaning up properties in the neighborhood. So it's enabled me to meet new people weekly and just spend time with them, sharing with them. And every week, multiple people, I get to just share the love of Christ with them by going in and just blessing them and just giving to some of their needs, cleaning up properties and things like that. There's a couple testimonies I would love to share with you. Not to glorify myself, that's for sure, but just to show that, you know, God, if you purpose your life to follow Him and do what He's called us to do, how He will use you. You know, there's a couple men that run a business that I have to work with, and you know, they're known to be, you know, pretty tough guys, pretty hard guys, and you know, they were gonna start charging me for getting rid of my brush and things like that, which was fine, but they, you know, questioned me on what it was I was doing, and you know, I got to share with them. You know, going and just being a blessing to people and their properties. And one of the owners I got to, you know, spend some time with and sharing with him how, you know, I'm sharing the Word of God with people out on the streets and loving on them. And as I'm working out there, I've, you know, God has moved people to go to rehab that have been struggling with addictions and things like that. And you know, our Victorious Living is a part of their follow-up after they get out of rehab. And this man shared with me, well, we need more things like that going on in Quincy. And then he asked me, you know, if I think about it while I'm out doing things to pray for him. And I shared with this man, you know, I'm not going to wait to do that. I'm going to pray for you right now. He was in his front end loader in the middle of his work day. And just climbed up there and talked to him and just laid my hands on him and just started praying for this man right in the middle of the workday. Other stuff going on, not worrying about what other people are thinking are doing. And as I began to pray for this man, I noticed tears started to come to his eyes as I was, you know, praying for the love of God to be revealed in his life. And I don't know exactly what God was doing in his life. He knows. And that's what's the amazing thing. And it isn't just because tears came. It's because we took the time to pray, which enabled the Holy Spirit to move and begin a work inside of this man. And, you know, after we prayed and I seen joy come on him, he was smiling. And I don't know what God was doing, but it was good. After I climbed down and I was walking away, another worker asked me, "Were you just praying with him?" And I said, "Yeah." And he looked at me very confused, like, what are you doing? We don't pray here or whatever. And I just started sharing with this man. And my testimony of coming out of drug addiction and a life of bondage. And, you know, another man right there just started opening up to me. And as I started sharing with him about how God loves him and how God sees him and what God's done for me in my life through Jesus Christ, this man started examining himself. And before I knew it, tears started coming out of his eyes. And he really started opening up. And I got to pray with him also. And just seeing God move on a daily routine in our daily lives. Not that I have to wake up just go from door to door, which there's nothing wrong with that. I'm just saying when we can't do that, our daily lives are to be lived as a testimony of Jesus Christ and the power that lives inside of us. We want to share with others, and God wants to work in other people's lives through us. I want to take a second. I want to, you know, look at a scripture in Romans 10, 11 through 15. And it says, "For the scripture says that whosoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there's no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." How then, in verse 14 it says, "How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things." You know, you are what some people are only going to know as the Bible or as being God's presence. How are others going to hear and know about this salvation and this deliverance and this life that God can bring to us without you and without you opening your mouth and sharing to others? And it's simply what we got to do. I know that each one of us and many that are watching today, we have that unction inside of us because the Holy Spirit is living inside of us. And when we have that unction to just share or to be that word of hope or that word of peace to another, I want to encourage you today to open up your mouth and be that voice of God that He can bring hope to somebody's life, that He can bring a positive note of sharing with somebody that man, if you turn to Jesus, if you put your trust in Him, He shall direct your paths. It's amazing. You see, when I was a younger person, before I really started to pursue God with my life, I always had a sense of God in my life. I remember being 16 years old. I had a friend in high school that had some physical problems in their life. My grandpa, he was a carver. He would carve things, and he made what was a prayer candle and gave it to us as kids. And I just kept it in my room. I never really used it. And it isn't the prayer candle that I'm talking about. And this is before I knew that God was a healer and all these things, but there was this sense inside of me that God is good and that He has answers for us. But I remember a friend coming to me with being under distress with some physical problems. They went to the doctor and might have to have a surgery. And I remember when I was 16, taking this person, lighting this prayer candle, and just taking a moment and praying with them. I never did it with anybody before in my life. It wasn't a common thing I did in my life. But we did. We took a minute to believe God would fix this problem. And what was amazing was a few days later, the person came back to me and said, "You know, what they had in there was gone." And instantly I went back to, man, we prayed about this. And the amazing thing was there was results that came from it. There was a miraculous healing that came from it. And there's no other explanation because things don't just disappear in the natural. But this person and I took the opportunity and put our faith in God together and believed him for something. And it came to pass. It was amazing. And we got to share that with other people. And this was before I really had a relationship with Jesus. But inside of me, there was some kind of sense, something that drew me to pray. And it was God just showing me how much he loves us and if we come to him. I remember my dad was diagnosed with a cancer probably a couple years after I was saved and was learning that, you know, who God is. God is a healer. And I remember my mom and I taking anointing oil and anointing his pillows and his handkerchiefs and doing all this behind his back and being in continuous prayer for him, my mom and I in agreement. And my dad was going for a visit before a surgery for the cancer. And when he went all the way to Columbia for his pre-visit, the cancer was gone. And he come back and he was excited. And he said, you know, it's gone. I don't understand it. And I said, Dad, you know what we've been doing? We have been anointing your pillows and we've been praying for you. I said, God healed you. And he was excited and he said, do you really think so? Do you really think? There's no other explanation. It was irrefutable. God healed him and it was an amazing thing. And it was the prayer of faith. It was my mother and I standing in agreement, putting our faith in God and God moving in the situation. My youngest son had an accident when he was just a couple years old. He was on a cousin's shoulders and we were walking on some big rocks and he accidentally slipped and fell off and landed on his ankle and it pulled tendons in his foot and really messed his foot up where he couldn't walk and we had to go to the hospital. But they were setting him up to see a surgeon and gave him a wheelchair. And I'll never forget this time because my oldest son at a family reunion laid hands on my youngest son and he prayed for him, the prayer of faith. And my son miraculously the next day was jumping off the couch onto the ground, let alone the day before he was in a wheelchair ready to go see a surgeon. But for reasons of God's goodness, he was healed jumping back and forth. We didn't even have to go see the surgeon. These are just a few testimonies of the miraculous power of God, the healing power, and that I want to share these with you to build your faith, that we serve a God that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly more than we ever thought or asked for. And he wants to do it in your life if we will put our faith in him and walk it out. I want to thank you for joining us today, and God bless you. In Jesus' name.
That Jesus lives and that he loves you. Today, give your heart to him. Give your heart to him. Just turn your life completely over to him right now and find a gospel-believing church and go and they'll explain more to you. Go and you will find out that Jesus is alive and he will begin to live in your heart and your life will change beginning right now. I pray that Jesus touch you in a mighty way, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, we're Pastors Jerry and Julie Jenkins, Addiction Free in Christ, a ministry of miracles. And this whole TV series is about the truth about addiction. So that's what we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about some of the addictions that we're struggling with in America today. And we ask you this, if you need help, if you know someone that needs help with any addiction, you can call us at 217-617-5577. That's 217-617-5577. Well, on these programs, we talked a lot about the opioid epidemic. We talked a lot about the drug problems we're facing in America, all the overdoses of people dying. But I want to switch gears a little bit. I want to talk about another addiction. Now, addiction that I'm very familiar with because I struggled with it for years, and that's alcoholism. The amount of people that die from alcoholism today is incredible. And the people struggling with it today is incredible. Because alcohol, social drinking today, is very popular many places. And so, Julie, let's look a little bit. Yeah, I know you've got some information as we're putting in our seminar book about alcoholism and the destruction it's doing, right?
Correct. Here's some alcohol statistics that we have. Alcohol poisoning kills 6 people every day. Of those, 76% are adults ages 35 to 64, and 3 of every 4 people are killed by alcohol, that are killed by alcohol poisoning are men. Alcohol impaired driving accounts for more than 30% of all driving fatalities each year. More than 15 million people struggle with alcohol use disorder in the United States, but less than 8% of those receive treatment.
Okay, now how many people, let's go through that again. How many people are struggling with alcoholism today in the United States?
15 million.
15 million, that's a lot of people, okay?
Yes, and also more than 65 million Americans report binge drinking in the past month, which is more than 40% of the total of current alcohol users. And the reason why this is so life-threatening also is that when people drink, they lose control, and people who use alcohol are 2 times more likely to be addicted to heroin. See, it's a gateway also to other drugs, and people lose control, they don't know what they're doing, and then they find themselves in a terrible situation.
Okay, let's go back with one other thing. It's a gateway drug to heroin. Okay, that's something we need to make.
I think that's important to note that there are people who use alcohol are 2 times more likely to be addicted to heroin. People who are addicted to marijuana are 3 times more likely to be addicted to heroin. People who use cocaine are 15 times more likely to be addicted to heroin. And opioid painkillers that are prescription are 40 more times likely to be addicted to heroin. So we see where it is opens the door. Now, you might be wondering, now how do I know whether someone is an alcoholic? There are certain signs of an alcoholic.
Well, let's talk about that for a minute. Let's go over that very slowly.
Sure. Number one, drinking by themselves in an effort to hide their addiction. You'll find that alcoholics have a tendency to drink by themselves, hide their bottles around the house. A spouse will find one hidden here and there. That's a sign of an addiction.
Okay, let's stop there for a minute. One thing that we've done and worked on a lot of times in the last years ourselves, you and I, so many women drinkers, many women drinkers that hide the alcohol all through the house, right?
Yes.
And so many women that really struggle with this. I mean, we've struggled with some, we worked with some ladies that were married to very prominent people.
Yes.
And people in government and other places. And they would hide their alcohol all through the house, wouldn't they, all over?
Correct.
And they're very serious. They're very difficult to work with because they hide it so well, they hide it from everybody, and they think no one realizes it but themselves.
Well, when people think of alcoholism, they often think of someone who's on the street who can't function at all, but there's something called a functional alcoholic where they're able to even hold down a job and act somewhat normal with their family members. Of course, the family members are the first ones to notice it because they become agitated if they don't have access to alcohol. They experience relationship, employment, and legal troubles. It always it starts compounding itself, snowballing.
Let's talk about the top of the legal problems for a minute.
Sure.
A DUI right now starts at $10,000. right?
Oh, yeah.
When you get a DUI today, you've just spent $10,000. You want to think about that before you drink and drive, right?
Right.
Because you're spending $10,000 of your hard-earned money. The other thing is, to be very honest with you, most alcoholics don't have $10,000 to waste because the alcoholism has usually got them almost broke themselves. Mm-hmm. Right, Julie?
Absolutely.
Okay. True. What else is on there?
True. And, the cost to our communities, alcohol, excessive alcohol use drains our economy. It costs the healthcare industry $28 billion. The work plus productivity, $179 billion, collisions, $13 billion, and criminal justice, $25 billion. That's a $249 billion loss.
A year?
I don't know on that.
Okay. Well, if this is probably, these statistics would be for a year.
It would probably be a year.
Yeah, it would be for a year.
I don't know what they don't have the time frame on that. So that's a good question.
Well, I'm sure it's for a year because they wouldn't have put it that way in that chart.
No.
Exactly. So that's not only costing
CDC.
You all these problems, it's costing the nation all these problems. It's costing the taxpayers all these problems. It's costing our law enforcement all these problems. So we have a very serious problem. We're so worried about the opioid epidemic, and I grant you, it's horrible. But we've got a lot of other problems with addiction beside it. And we're going to be talking about that in these later weeks in these programs. We're going to be discussing sexual addiction. We're going to be discussing kleptomania, which is it's an addiction. There's a lot of other things that, besides the opioid epidemic, that we're struggling with. But alcohol is one of the major problems. One of the major problems we have to get our hands on. You know, people don't realize this, but we're fighting, when we fight with addiction, we're fighting a spiritual battle, actually. And I want to take us to somewhere that talks about that whole thing. The addiction problem is a spiritual battle that cannot be solved by a theory of man. There's no program in the world that anybody ever wrote that's going to solve the addiction problem. The only program and the only thing that will solve the addiction problem is this right here, God's Word. It says this. Let's go to Ephesians 6:12. It says this, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against the spiritual host of wickedness in heavenly places." We're dealing with, you know, the thing that most people don't understand, if they don't really study the Bible, and they don't really read the Bible, there are things called demons. They're spiritual beings. There's angels. We talked about that, and Julie and I do a chaplain service for the senior center. And last week we preached on angels. We shared with the people about angels. There's angels. The Bible talks about that. And the Bible talks about demons, spiritual beings. They're real live beings. You know, if you drive by a liquor store, a lot of times you'll see a sign that says, wine and spirits, right? Every time you take a drink of alcohol in your system, you open up your system to every spirit from hell that there is. Now, you may think that's crazy, but that's what the Bible says. We do not wrestle with flesh and blood, but principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. Every time you take an illegal drug, you open up yourself to a spirit that's coming in to control you. Talk about addiction. Addiction is something that controls my mind and my behavior. Addiction is something you can never get enough of. Addiction constantly grows. It's progressive. Addiction just doesn't start and all of a sudden, well, I'll drink a beer tonight and that'll be it. Addiction grows. And so you take the alcohol addiction and it grows and grows and grows and grows and grows. And finally, you have to take another one on. And it grows and grows and grows and grows. I know this because I was one of these people. I was addicted to alcohol. I was addicted to cigarettes. I was addicted to gambling. Addiction constantly has to have more. You know, God, once we surrender our life to Jesus Christ, He's all we need. You know, I, in a lot of these churches, I remember singing songs, Jesus is all I need, Jesus is all I need. Well, that's true. That's all you need is Jesus Christ. But alcohol or any other addiction, it will never satisfy. You always want more. Have you ever met anybody? Well, remember, this reminds me of something we used to talk about. Remember you'd open a bag of potato chips and say, you can't eat just one potato chip?
Yeah.
Well, that's the way with addiction. You can't smoke just one cigarette. You can't just take one drink of alcohol a day. You can't just take one hit of a joint. You can't just take one shot a day. It don't work. Addiction is progressive. It controls your life. You know, I want you to go to Romans, I think it is, in the sixth chapter, where it says, don't you know that who you present yourselves slaves to obey, you're that one slave who you obey, whether sin leading to death or obedience leading to righteousness? Let's look at that real quick. That explains addiction better than anything in the world. And so, Romans, the sixth chapter, and it says this, do you not know that who you present yourselves slaves to obey, you're that one slave who you obey, whether sin leading to death or obedience to righteousness? And then it goes on to say, but God be thanked, though you were slaves of sin, you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which you were delivered. It doesn't say anything about recovery. You know, there's many recovery programs out there. It's wonderful. They help people stay sober one day at a time. But when you surrender your life to God, it's deliverance. Jesus said, if the Son make you free, you shall be free indeed. And He said this, if you, John 8, 31 and 32, if you abide my word, you're my disciples indeed. And you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. See, whatever you're struggling with today, you don't have to be a slave to it anymore. Whatever's controlling your life and destroying your life, destroying your income, destroying your family, destroying everything you have, you don't have to have anymore. All you have to do is just give up and surrender to Jesus. Just say, Jesus, I want you to be the Lord of my life. I surrender my life to you. I've tried for years and I can't handle this alone. But I believe in you. And I believe that once I surrender to you, I believe your word is true. And today I'm going to accept that deliverance. I'm going to accept that freedom. Today, Jesus, just come in my life and set me free that I can live and be set free from this problem. Amen.
In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers.